Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the basic configuration of BGP confederations on Cisco IOS routers. If you find this video informative, don't forget to click the thumbs up button. And if you like the content, make sure you subscribe to get updates to newly uploaded videos. Now, in a previous video, I introduced BGP confederations and talked about the logic behind them and how they help to resolve the limitations introduced by eBGP's full mesh peering requirement. If you haven't seen that video yet, it may be helpful to take a look. A link can be found in the description below. In this video, we'll take a look at the basic configuration necessary on Cisco IOS routers to configure BGP confederations. Now, we won't go in depth into how they're configured, but we will take a look at the logic behind the specific commands used to implement confederations. So let's take a look at the topology that we'll be using to describe how it should be configured. Here we have a confederation called AS100, and within that confederation, we have two sub-ASs. AS65001 and 65002. We also have another BGP AS here, which is AS200. Now, all of these routers have been configured with a loopback zero interface with IP addresses equivalent to their router number. For example, R2 has an IP address on its loopback of 2.2.2.2, R3 has 3.3.3.3, and so on. All of them have also been configured so that the source of their BGP peering is that loopback zero interface. Now, the routing between routers R2, R3, R4, and R5 has been established as well, since we have configured an IGP to allow all of these routers within the AS to be able to reach each other. Remember, within an AS, we need to have routing established, and this is typically done using an IGP to ensure that all routers are reachable to each other. Now, at this point, we don't have any routes to advertise, so we're just looking at the configuration of the BGP peerings between these routers based on the ASs and the sub-ASs that we have designed here. Now, for the time being, we're going to take a look at how the establishment of peering takes place within the confederation. We're not yet looking at our eBGP peerings. Now, let's take a look at the BGP configuration of R2. We're not yet establishing peers, we're just setting up the AS numbers. First, we see that we start with the BGP process using the router BGP command, and we issue the AS number of the sub-AS, which is 65002. And we're not actually using the AS number of the confederation itself, which is 100. So this tells the local router to which sub-AS it belongs. Next, we issue the BGP Confederation Identifier command. Now, this is the command that tells the router to which confederation it belongs. Here, we use AS100 as the confederation identifier. So the router now knows its sub-AS as well as its confederation AS. Next, we have to issue the BGP Confederation Peers command. Now, this command tells the router what other sub-AS numbers exist within the local confederation. In our case, we only have one other sub-AS, which is 65001. So we simply put that in the command. But what if we had more sub-ASs? In that case, we would have to list them here. And the command can actually accept multiple AS numbers separated by spaces, so you can simply list them in one single command. All the sub-ASs of the confederation must be listed here. Otherwise, the confederation will not function. Next, let's see how peering is established within the confederation. We'll first look at peering within sub-AS 65002. Initially, we see the neighbor command issued here with the loopback address of R4, which is 4.4.4.4. Note here that we are using a remote AS of 65002, which is the sub-AS in which R4 resides. So far, this looks like a regular eBGP peering. We can also see here the update source loopback zero command, and that's used to indicate that the source of the BGP messages from R2 will be the local loopback zero interface. Now let's take a look at R2's peering with R3. Now this is an inter-sub AS iBGP peering. Here you can see that the neighbor command is used, indicating the IP address of the remote peer, which is 3.3.3.3. But we use a remote AS of 65001, which is the AS number of the sub AS in which R3 resides. We also issue the update source loopback zero command to make sure that all BGP messages to that neighbor are sent from the local loopback address. Now, so far, this looks like an eBGP peering, and actually it behaves like an eBGP peering. And that's why we also need to add the eBGP multi-hop 2 command here. Because we're using our loopback interfaces, we have to tell the protocol that R2 and R3 do not appear directly connected, since they're not using their physical interface IP addresses, which would have been in the same subnet. Now, I won't go further into the multi-hop command here. I'll cover that in another video. But for now, it's enough to say that this peering actually acts like an eBGP peering. Now, the router knows that this is not an eBGP peering because of the Confederation identifier and the Confederation peer commands configured above. Now, what does the BGP configuration look like on R3? Well, it's very similar. Take a look at it here. We see the initial BGP router process configuration indicating the sub AS of 65001. We see the Confederation identifier of AS100 and the Confederation peers, which in this case is only the one peer set at 65002. Next, we see the peering with R5, which is the router in the same sub AS as R3, with a remote AS of 65001, and the peering with R2, which is in a different sub AS, and that has a remote AS of 65002. And because it behaves like eBGP, again, we need that eBGP multi-hop command in there as well. Now, one other thing I want to show you is what the eBGP peering looks like, that peering that exists between R1 and R2. Now, remember, AS's outside of the Confederation will see a Confederation only as a single normal AS. So R1 here will see AS100 as a normal AS. It won't see the internal sub-ASs at all. Now, let's say for this particular eBGP peering, these routers use the IP addresses of their physical interfaces rather than the loopback interfaces. And we can see the configured physical interface IP addresses here. The resulting eBGP configuration on R1 will look like this. It's just a normal eBGP peering with the correct local and remote AS numbers. On R2, the eBGP configuration will look like this. Now, I've included the BGP Confederation commands here just to remind us that these have already been established. Now, the eBGP peering configuration here is not what you would expect in a normal eBGP peering. But because R2 exists within a sub-AS, that sub-AS is indicated here. But because we have the BGP Confederation identifier of 100, which is set here, when it peers with R1, it'll advertise that AS as its own AS. So R1 will never see AS number 65002. Now, just a couple of things to remember. This configuration only deals with the creation of the peerings of BGP routers in a Confederation's environment. We haven't advertised any routes at all. We're just creating the relationships between the different types of iBGP and eBGP routers. Secondly, unlike other routing protocols like OSPF or EIGRP, it's important to remember that all of these peerings must be configured manually. So when creating confederations, it's always a good idea to have your design specifically devised beforehand and then to manually configure it. So that's the basic configuration methodology used on Cisco IOS routers to create BGP confederations. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click the thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And as always, please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.